Okay, I guess we're gonna start. Hello, everybody. Good evening. My name is Ali Raad Muattar. I go by Raad, and me and my colleague, great friend, Dr. Tran, Dan Tran.
Hey, everyone.
We got together a presentation for you regarding challenging cases in endodontics. Well, as I said, Raad and Tran is more to me like a Batman and Superman, providing this lecture for you.
And no, we are not sponsored by Figs.
Right, that's another thing. Well, just all by accident, so there's no intention. So what I'm gonna cover today and talk about cracks and root fractures, something that on daily basis, either as a specialist or a general dentist, we deal with it. And somehow it can become very challenging. Let's first have a little bit of introduction about these two entities. A crack tooth is the crack usually originates in a coronal structure and extend apically. The crack typically orients mesiodistally, involves the marginal ridges, includes the proximal surface of the tooth, and most commonly is seen either on the mandibular molars, maxillary molars, or maxillary premolars. On the other hand, we have the vertical root fracture, which occur in previously endodontically treated, originate within the root, begin apically and extend coronally. Generally orient in the buccolingual direction, most commonly on the maxillary premolars, and often associated with the use of post or over preparation of the canal. And most of the time, they have a hopeless prognosis. The first case I'm gonna show, I'm gonna start with a few cases about the crack, then we're gonna get to vertical root fracture. This patient presented with a severe pair on the lower right side, middle age male. The tooth tested necrotic, number 31. As you can see, we couldn't take a periapical radiograph. Patient had a very strong gag reflex, so we exposed a CBCT. On a CT scan, we can see the periapical lesion as well as some bone loss on the distal. Clinically, we could detect a crack. So we discussed the treatment option with the patient, whether we can go and treat the tooth endodontically and chase that crack and see how far it goes, or have the tooth extracted. Patient was on board and wanted to save the tooth. Upon accessing the tooth, you will see there's a crack going apically toward the orifice of the tooth. Root canal treatment completed, and we restored the tooth with resin composite. The way it works, the way we treated cases like this after obturation, few millimeters below the fracture line, we inject the dual cure composite and fill the whole canal, the crack, and the axis. And hoping that by proper full coverage restoration, this tooth can survive, and also we put the tooth completely out of occlusion. The next case is something very similar to that, is a different tooth, number 18. The reason I put this slide, I just wanted to show you a little video about how we restore these sort of fractures. After complete obturation of the tooth, we remove gutta-percha a few millimeters below the fracture line. After bonding with a very small tip, composite tip, we inject the dual cure resin material into the canal below the fracture line, as well as a pulp chamber and towards the crack. We place it in a layer. I'm not gonna bore you looking at the whole thing, but this is pretty much the way we restore it. Why this type of restoration? Why are we hoping here? So this coming based on several literature, one of the most popular one that been recently published in JOE is from Davis and Sharif, 2019. The goal of this study was to examine the survival rate of endodontically treated coronally cracked teeth, specifically where the crack extend beyond the level of the orifice and inside the root. What result they found? They found that almost after 2 years, 100% of the case, they had survival rate. And in the period of 2 to 4 years, 96% of the cases, they survived. The overall success that they classified as success in 2 to 4 years was 90%. So what they conclude here was that the success and survival rate of cracked teeth with radicular extension of the crack may be similar to endodontically treated in general. And it shows a promising result compared to previous studies. What did they define as a success? If the tooth is asymptomatic within those 2 to 4 years, there is no clinical sign of infection like sinus tract, no sensitivity to percussion, palpation, or bite test, and the tooth was fully functional, having a full cuspal coverage restoration. The periodontal depth were not increased more than a millimeter from the initial treatment. Also, no increase in crestal alveolar bone loss was noted in radiograph, and normal appearing periodicular structure. So what we want to achieve based on these studies and this way of treating is that the treatment outcome of the cracked teeth with radicular extension may be improved by using the following protocol. Microscope assisted intra-orifice barrier placed apical to the extent of the crack, complete occlusal reduction, specific post-operative instruction, and prompt placement of the full cuspal coverage restoration. From now on, I'm going to show a few more cases that they're either crack or we're not truly sure is crack. This patient showed up with severe pain on upper right side. As you can see, the tooth is heavily decayed. Number 3 tested necrotic with exposed CBCT. As you can see in one of the slices, we have huge bone loss on the palatal, almost no cortical bone. Clinical evaluation showed swelling on palatal, isolated 9 millimeter pocket. These teeth, to me, they're the most trickier one. This is a situation of egg or chicken situation. You don't know if this tooth has this probing and swelling because of the crack or simply because you got necrotic. So we always would like to treat the teeth in 2 visits to see if we can improve the symptoms. The patient was on board, was very motivated to save the tooth, access the tooth. No crack was detected internally. Medicated the tooth with calcium hydroxide for 2 weeks. Patient came back. Still, we have isolated pocket on the mid palatal. Symptoms got better. Swelling definitely went down. Again, the reason that we treated this teeth in 2 visits, first we see the symptoms subside, and also the patient has the time to think about it, about the prognosis if they're very keen to save it. Patient wanted to save the tooth, obturation completed. I've decided to restore this tooth with a little bit more sturdy and strong restoration, temporary restoration. I placed KeyTag and I would like to see the patient in a month. I just finished this case recently and I want to see the patient in a month to have another evaluation. Especially I want to see if the probing depth is gone before he proceed with the final restoration. Very similar case, female, middle age, presented with huge swelling on the palatal, a necrotic case. The tooth was initiated by the general dentist right before the COVID, and the patient could not go to complete the treatment due to the situation, and showed up in our office with as an emergency. Again, we exposed the CBCT, very similar to the previous case, huge bone loss, huge swelling on palatal. Went over the treatment option with the patient. Patient wanted to save the tooth, decided to proceed with pulpectomy and also incision drainage for the first visit. Upon accessing the tooth, we could express pus from the canal. A crack was located on the palate, so it's a bit different from the former case. However, we medicated the tooth and also performed the IND. Just a little video about, just to show you how the discharge was. We didn't even need to do anything, just a little incision and it's draining. Hopefully you're not having dinner right now watching this. And we medicated the tooth with calcium hydroxide. Patient came back in a couple of weeks. The probing depth decreased significantly, like about 3-4 millimeters. The palatal swelling is gone. In this case, it is more promising. I have hopes that, okay, now we know is it egg or chicken, because it most probably the tooth just got necrotic and it was not due to the fracture. And we decided to complete the treatment. Hopefully in our recall, we'll see improvement and patient has no symptoms. Right away, once I finished this case, I posted this case on my Instagram page, and a dear friend of mine, he's a prosthodontist in Vancouver, wrote me this beautiful note saying, great job, know that the area is healing, patient can wait for another 4 to 5 months and then have it extracted and replace it by an implant in that beautiful interradicular bone that you have gained. And before the medial wall and other parts break and cause a new abscess, it's called interdisciplinary treatment planning. And Raad, which is me, is an important member of the team. We're glad that we can really help our fellow prosthodontists here, save him some time for bone grafting and all this stuff, you know, to just can go extract the tooth, and right away the bone is pretty healed there, and place the implant. Another approach to look at this. Another case, another crack tooth, patient, female in her late 20s, presented with excruciating pain on upper left side. We exposed PA and bite fin number 15, tested necrotic. You can hardly see any bone loss associated with the tooth. We took photos. This is a typical manifestation of the cracked tooth when you see mesiodistally extension of the crack. Also, we have a 9 millimeter pocket on the mesiobuccal aspect of the tooth. Mesiolingual aspect of the tooth. Patient was a bit skeptical about the treatment, was asking a lot of questions about whether it's crack or not. We exposed a CT scan, sent the CT scan to the radiologist for further evaluation. The radiologist whatsoever, they couldn't detect any fracture line. So I explained to the patient, until we go inside the tooth, we cannot really tell you what's happening and how extensive is that. Patient was on board to save the tooth. Upon accessing the tooth, we see those mesial and distal fractures. They extend into the pulp chamber. Again, medicate the tooth. Patient has time to think about it. In this case, patient didn't want to invest on this questionable prognosis and decided to have it extracted. Another interesting case, recently done. This patient had a restoration placed on number 3 a few weeks ago, and since then she had discomfort. The first instinct is that, okay, because of the restoration, some pulpal irritation has happened, but patient has sensitivity to bite and lingering to cold. No periapical lesion. We exposed a CBCT to see if we can further see any problem with the tooth. So on the axial view, in one area, you can see some bone loss on the mesial of the tooth. So this is where we guess there is a crack. So we access the tooth. Right away, you can see there is a crack underneath that restoration. We have the microscope and we can see that crack is extending from mesial to distal. usually the reason I put this picture because usually the pulp, the appearance of the pulp is very bloody, shows a high level of inflammation. And again, we use methylene blue and you can see the crack on the mesial aspect of the tooth. I put this video after to show you how we would like to restore this kind of situation. What we would like to do is chasing that crack, open up that crack as much as we can and open the contact completely to be able to place our resin material inside the crack. I know it might not be ideal, but at least until the patient gets a full cuspal coverage that can hold things together. So the final came out like this, and as you can see, we were able to introduce and apply those build-up material, resin material, into the crack. Similar case, since I have a follow-up on this one, I just thought I would put this one, number 14, necrotic case, moderate size amalgam restoration, open accessing, you can see on the mesial, there is a fracture line. Obturation completed, restored same procedure, restored the mesial crack, penetrated all the way into the crack. And we have 1 year recall. The tooth is still there. That's good. With a proper full coverage restoration. Another case, this patient was referred for evaluation of number 3. So the referral says patient has symptoms to cold and hot. So my first instinct is that, okay, there's no way, even if it's a poorly done root canal treatment, there's no way the patient can have cold or hot sensitivity. So I'm looking at other teeth. Upon evaluation, looking under the microscope, we can see there is a crack on the distal marginal ridge next to the amalgam. This is one of the disadvantages of amalgam, that over time they would act like a wedge and cause some minor crack, and eventually patient has pulpal symptoms. So the tooth tested irreversible pulpitis, informed the patient the root canal is needed if she wants to save the tooth. Patient was on board. We accessed, before that we took a CT scan, like similar to other cases, to see if we can see any bone loss. If you like squint your eyes, maybe you'll see something. I couldn't see, I just had to play it several times, telling myself, oh, there's bone loss. I see a little, but you can easily miss it. So we accessed the tooth. In this case, the fracture line was not extended into the chamber. These are teeth that have a very good prognosis with a proper full cuspal restoration, full cuspal coverage restoration. We finished the case and patient was referred back to a general dentist for final restoration. Now I want to talk a little bit about root fractures. This is from Walton 2017. Things that we want to see in root fractures is the pattern of the bone loss that we can even see in a two-dimensional x-ray. These are the patterns, some sort of dehiscence in the middle of the root. As you can see, root fracture usually start from the either middle of the root or apical part of the root, and they go all the way up. And their orientation is also buccolingual. This patient came to us, root canal was done 10, 15 years ago, no problem whatsoever. Again, this is my personal observation. If the patient had no problem on a root canal treated tooth, and then after 10 years they have symptoms, it's not always true, but most of the time a fracture has happened. So on the biting, we can see some bone loss on the distal. We took a PA, bone loss on the distal, periapical lesion, beautiful work done on this tooth. Nothing to improve. And also we have about 12 millimeter pocket. Told the patient that right after bat, this tooth most likely it's fractured. If there's a slight chance that we can save the tooth, we need to take a CT scan and do further evaluation. Patient didn't want to invest on this and decided to have it extracted. Another example about root fracture. This patient was referred for retreatment, middle-aged lady, symptoms to biting, chewing, and sinus tract. So one of the other great tool that we can detect the fracture is if we trace that sinus tract with the gutta percha. Usually if there is a periapical lesion, that gutta percha will point the apex of the tooth. But in this case, as you can see, it goes almost to the middle of the root. So this is another way to indicate this is not a periapical lesion causing that sinus tract, and most likely it's a fracture. Another signs of the fracture is isolated pocket associated with sinus tract, and in this case, two sinus tract. So at first, we might think, oh, maybe there's another tooth got infected. I tested the adjacent teeth, everything was vital, but why we have this? Why there is two sinus tract? So we expose a CBCT. When we go on the axial view again, we will see that in one area, that infection from tooth number 19 is trying to drain from two different parts. Basically, the infection tried to find the least resistant path to drain. That's why on some cases we might see multiple sinus tract. This is basically the way the pus wants to come out. It has nothing to do with the adjacent teeth. So inform the patient this tooth will have. Patient was very motivated to save the tooth, and I just had to tell her, sorry, we have to throw in the towel, it's not gonna work. I know there might be some other alternative option like root resection, root amputation, but I thought this one will not have good outcome considering the compromised tooth structure while we have implant and other alternatives, so we should probably proceed with those. This is another case, again, I would call it very tricky. The reason I say that is a previously root canal treated tooth. Your first reaction is that, okay, it's fractured if there's a lesion, because not only we see a periapical lesion, we will see a lesion in forcation. Again, we expose the CBCT on an axial view. We see missing MB2. On another slice, we can explain this periapical lesion, that's because of that MB2, but why is coming all the way up to the forcation and we had 12 millimeter pocket? So this could be like a combination of both. Patient was very motivated to save the tooth as long as she could. We could find the missing anatomy, the MB2. Again, treated the tooth in two visits with calcium hydroxide. Patient came back, still 12 millimeter pocket. I had to have a conversation that, you know, this is most likely a fracture. We didn't see anything internally, but it could be a root fracture. And now we found all the diseased pulp and diseased tissue inside the tooth and is not healing. So this will have a very questionable guarded prognosis. Patient wanted to save, and again, I don't like it. I see this bone loss here. We just proceeded with what patient would like to do for now. Another typical case of root fracture. We might look at it and say, oh, it's a poorly done root canal treatment. That's why it got infected. But even on a two-dimensional X-ray, you can see a huge amount of bone loss. 12 millimeter pocket on the mid-buccal, 12 millimeter pocket on the distal. This is like too much for a little tooth. And we just told the patient that it has to be extracted. As you can see, this is a typical example of the root fracture starting from the apex going to the top. Well, that's all about it. I try to keep it short and sweet and not bore you guys with a bunch of literatures. Just show you a few cases, the way we treat them in endocare. And the goal here is that even some literature says, okay, if you see this sign, the tooth has to come out. The goal is that if the patient is motivated and is on board, try to save the tooth. This is what I tell always the patient. What if this tooth stay for you another 5 years? Are you up for it? Most of them, they are. I am. So unless there's like vertical root fracture, like some cases I show it to you, yeah, this is, we don't want to give hope to the patient. And so we cannot always go by the literature or what is in the book. We have to see what is feasible clinically and what is good for the patient. So I thought maybe I gathered these cases to be helpful for you guys and helpful for the patient. So from this part, I give the rest of the lecture to Superman. So he's going to take over and step out. Have a good day.
Well, I guess, first of all, let's see if there's any questions.
Yeah.
I'm not kind of new to Zoom, so we need to figure out how to do this. I guess no questions. Well, if you have any questions, feel free to type it in and we'll get
sure, back we to can you. Answer you at the end of Dr. Tran lectures.
But let's switch gears here. Thank you, Dr. Ali Rad.
No problem.
Let me help. Bring up that discussion. It's a really tough decision point. I think that's one of the hardest things as endodontists we have. We have to come up with this decision point for patients to save or extract, and a lot of it's based off of clinical presentation, and also there's a big range of patient tolerances, right? You know, one patient's biting sensitivity can be very mild for one patient, versus for another patient it can be, you know, excruciating. So there's that fine line that we need to guide patients to make the right decision for them.
Exactly. Let me just pull this one out. Okay. There we go.
All right. So we're going to switch gears here, talk about other challenging cases in endodontics. I would say this is less of a decision standpoint and more of a, I guess, technical sort of lecture. We're going to talk about difficult cases, and especially with regards to restorations. So showing you a couple cases here. These are my favorite cases. You know, we have a nice occlusal table. I can access through the center of the tooth. I know exactly where the pulp chamber is, and obviously the tooth is restorable because it is restored already. In this case with the recent crown, endo is often the easy, a relatively easy part with regards to saving teeth here. Here's another case, access through the crown, repaired with hydrofluoric acid, resin composite filling on the top. Here's another case here. I really like these cases because I can try to keep the access as minimal as possible, locate all the canals with a microscope, of course. Here's another case here, obliterated tooth, trauma related, kind of difficult, but at least I'm not dealing with the deep, difficult restorations like I'll present here throughout the rest of the lecture. So that being said, I do want to preface this. There's so many talented people out there, a lot of general dentists, of course, who are, well beyond, you know, any of our clinical abilities as far as doing restorations. But I think the key for these cases that I'm going to present here is magnification. You know, I think that's one thing that we do have at our disposal that do help us treat these kind of cases, especially dealing with these restorations is, you know, dealing with the timing of it. You know, we're in the tooth, we're working in the canals, everything's already isolated, the patient's comfortable. So I'm a big advocate for doing these type of restorations right away, getting the tooth sealed up so that there's nothing leaking or just questioning our treatment after we're finished. Anyways, so with those deep restorations, you know, there's, I know Dr. Hamid and Dr. Milan gave a great presentation last time talking about when to save, when to extract, talking about biologic width, does the tooth need crown lengthening, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not gonna talk much about those because it was talked about in depth last time. You know, options for very questionable teeth. You know, you can either try to save it with guarded restorative prognosis, or you can go a more predictable route sometimes is just go ahead and extract it. What are your options to extract? Well, the best option these days, obviously, is implant. Other options, bridge, partial denture, nothing. I'm not gonna go into those details right now, but you know, a patient comes in with a broken down tooth, you know, I have to ask, well, why is the patient in my chair? That decision point has already been discussed by the general dentist. You know, they've already discussed the options that I just talked about there, extract or try to save the tooth. Well, a patient comes in with a broken down tooth. Well, I already have a good feeling that they want to try to save the tooth. Of course, I'm going to go through the options again with them after I've made my clinical assessment of it. But really though, they want to try to save the tooth and I'm here to help them to the best of my ability. Well, why save compromised teeth? Well, you know, there's a big swing, a pendulum, you know, in decades past to just extract teeth, go ahead and, you know, do an implant. But now over the past decade or two, the pendulum is swinging back towards trying to save the teeth. Even teeth that are highly guarded, you know, periodontally, and you know, there's these periodontists talking about periodontitis, and there's a big range of you know, complications dealing, ranging from periodontal disease, periodontitis, as well as prosthetic failure as well. So it's, you know, implants are a great option, but they're not the, you know, they're often not the only option. So it's good to present the patient with these different choices. I myself, I mean, I did a GPR after dental school. I placed a number of implants. I even had early failures with implants. And so I know from a personal level that, you know, it's not fun, you know, putting an implant and you have a spinner, you have certain complications that just, you know, they're there to try to do this treatment and then something goes wrong. So, you know, what now? So it is the end, the terminal kind of treatment. So if there's some sort of way that we can try to save these teeth beforehand, well, we're the last stop here. A couple resources here. I'm not gonna go into too much detail as far as literature, but these are very practical and good references I like to, I have gone through and I really find a big value in them. First off is that book on the left. We have Rick Schwartz and Venkat Kanakapalli. Really skilled endodontist, very, I've learned a lot through this book. It talks about everything from endodontics to restorative aspects of treatment to CBCT. It's a very good book that that I read from cover to cover, and I highly recommend it. Over to the right, there's a paper. It's by Pascal Magne. He's a clinical faculty over at USC. there's a treatment trend going towards deep margin elevation these days. These broken down teeth typically in the past often relied on crown lengthening, creating more ferrule essentially for crowns to grab onto and have more resistance to fracture and dislodgement and et cetera. But nowadays, bonding protocols are improving. We're isolating teeth better. There's different ways to treat these teeth. Not to say that crown lengthening is bad at all. It can be in certain cases, of course. You don't want to remove bone in certain situations where you want to keep that for a future implant. But there is another option here, and that is deep margin elevation sometimes to create a margin for your crown onlay, et cetera, onto say resin composite itself. So long as the bonding underneath it all, the bonding interface with the tooth and the resin is, or amalgam for that matter, is a well sealed and isolated margin. So let's move forward. Isolation is critical. Rubber dam is essential, especially in endodontics, especially even with the COVID these days. I think it's hopefully making a comeback in day-to-day practice. But anyways, that's something that we use, of course, in endodontics, and it's nice that we already have everything isolated. There is a clamp that I like to use. It's called the Silker-Glickman clamp. I'll show you an example of that in a bit here. It looks like a large clamp, but most patients are totally fine with it. It has extra long wings on it. I can do a slot dam surrounding three teeth or so, essentially allowing me to do these, this work inapproximately, dealing with the hemostasis, do a gingivectomy, et cetera. There's tools at our disposal to manage the soft tissue and bleeding, electrocautery, laser. I like to use the System B. We have it available at our disposal. Works very nicely to manage the bleeding. I'll talk about those different matrices in these cases that I'll show moving forward. Over to the right, actually, that's pre-COVID, of course. I'm working on a patient. Posture's okay. I'm not leaning back in the chair like I should be. But anyways, we can see in the screens to the right, we have live monitors available on our walls there. And it's not only just to look nice, but it is nice to be able to record our treatment there and be able to educate patients as to what we did, and I can show them cracks, etc. It's nice to have. Let me just show you this so I can take a sip of water also. But MacGyver is I don't exactly know what he is. He's a hero of some sort, but he always created these contraptions that would save the day. And sometimes I feel like
check it out.
We're doing the same thing.
Looks about right.
Just have to position our collector now.
We're getting a bead.
Trick is to heat up the ejector port. Then the shell inside. The gun oil's already smoking.
When that powder gets hot enough, it's gonna blow.
Exactly. Hopefully take the gas tank with it.
Anyways, Yeah, the point is, you know, there's a lot of tools to use to get the job done. MacGyver knows how to get the job done. So, anyways, we'll talk about the most simple simple tool. The first thing that we know, learn how to use in dental school, it's the Toffelmeyer, you know, the classic. But with that though, there are different bands to use at, you know, at your disposal. There's greater curved bands that can get more of a funnel shaped contour there. But look at the one on the bottom there. There's that margin elevation band, and that actually can be done by anyways, you can actually trim a regular band like that one shown on the bottom right. Basically what this does is it allows you to get a deeper sort of grab without the tension pulling at the top. It's hard to describe, but it's good to try. That Pascal Magne article does describe it fairly well. Over on the top right, that's the Silker Glickman clamp. Basically, you can isolate three different teeth. You can even add different tools to it, such as oval dam, etc., to secure it and create these customized matrices that I often like to do. So here's a pretty bummed out tooth here, chronic apical abscess, is that sinus tract, decay on the distal, goes subgingivally, but not terribly deep. I think this is a savable tooth. There is furcation involvement, so I'm not sure how much I'd want to do some crown lengthening there. I don't want to expose the furcation, but patient was on board with trying to save the tooth here. So I did the two-step process, medicated with calcium hydroxide, brought him back, sinus tract healed. Top left shows that Silker Glickman clamp, and I put some opal dam around the tooth to sort of create like a well, allowing more disinfection, more sodium hypochlorite to remain in the chamber there. Top right, root canal finished. Bottom left here, used just a regular Toffelmeyer band. I was able to get the band to secure nicely around the margins. No problem here, really. I did put some fiber post in here. I like to be very conservative with the fiber post. I don't like to drill away dentin to create that space. So, you know, I think it's, you know, I put two in here, but I don't think it's detrimental to put two so long as you're not drilling away dentin in order to do so. So bottom right, that's the final product there. Put a little finishing line on the distal so that it could be cleansable, as well as just create the next step to be easier for the general dentist. Next up, we have a double matrix. This is like a combination of the two. Oftentimes you can just secure a Toffelmeyer and even put a sectional matrix in there to get that deep down portion. I like to put the sectional part first and then the Toffelmeyer around it. It kind of just closes the gaps where needed. And sometimes you can even pack a little bit of wedge or Teflon tape to sort of close any sort of gaps that you may find in there. Here's an example of that. Top left, caries almost to the bone. I'm sorry, I don't have a bite wing of this, but bottom right is the isolated tooth. We have a sectional band kind of along the inner portion of this Toffelmeyer here. I didn't need any sort of Teflon or anything here. We have MB2 finished product on the bottom right. Then we have the two-step matrix. This one here, for some reason, you know, I couldn't get a Toffelmeyer on it. I couldn't quite seal the gingival gap there. Maybe that those root tips were getting in the way. But anyways, you know, I often try to go in that sequence, and you know, the most easy approach is to get a Toffelmeyer on there. But if I'm having difficulties, I'll go down that sort of list until I find something that works. In this case, I decided to just go ahead and rebuild, is it the mesial or distal? I, yeah, rebuild part of the wall there with a sectional band. Once I got that rebuilt a little bit, I went ahead and wrapped a typical top of mine around it. Put in a couple fiber posts in there. Got a nice contour there. Basically, it's ready to go for the next step. The referring dentist can go ahead and crown prep or do anything that they want to do with it.
What are you doing? Shit, no, that's it next time.
I don't know about that one. Let's see here. Saddle matrix. This is something kind of thinking outside the box. I looked online on Amazon to see if there's any little tools that could be used. This one actually proved to be a really good investment of $20. That little triangular piece is the spring action that you can use to hold on to this this matrix here and get around any sort of tooth. It kind of stays out of the way of the clamp itself, as you can see here. So here's a lower right second molar, deep decay to the osseous crest. Barely was able to get some sort of clamp on it. So I went ahead and cleaned everything out. Sometimes what I'll even do, I will actually even trim away some of the clamp itself if needed, in order to just facilitate the rest of the procedure. In this case, I think I may have trimmed it a little bit. But anyways, here's that saddle matrix in place. Got a nice, really nice seal on a distal buckle part right there. Nice seal there, and here's the bite wing and PA. Really happy how that one turned out. Next up, we have a copper band matrix. This is also another indispensable tool. I really use this a lot these days. I think Patterson has it. A lot of people are asking me, oh, where do you get the copper bands? Well, Patterson has it. I've got the 100 pack of assorted sizes. But really the size doesn't really matter because I cut them all. I cut a little piece, I cut a little half, you know, a semicircle or, you know, whatever I need in order to get that matrix on there because it's very malleable. I can burnish it against the margins, wrap it around the tooth. I can also even put opal dam around it to secure it in whatever way that I need to. This one's, you know, this one patient came in, doctor broke the tooth off at the gum line. What can I do? Obviously, this has a fairly guarded prognosis, and a very minimal ferrule, but they wanted to save it, so here we are. I went ahead and isolated it with a slot dam here. Completed the endo, sized in the post. Usually I like to leave at least 4 to 5 millimeters at the apex and then get as far down with the fiber post as possible without removing dentin, of course. Here's that copper band. Middle picture, I think there's a little gap. I believe I did seal that. Probably pack some Teflon in there. But you can see off to the right, there's opal band kind of just spot welding that into place. Put in the fiber post, did some build up around it, polished it down, and the patient walked out with a brand new tooth in front, and pretty happy how that turned out. This one was a tricky one. The dentist had sent over this patient. The plan was to actually extract number 31. But I said, you know what, let's hang on to that for now because I think I need it. I need it to go ahead and hold on to this clamp. We have that Silker Glickerman clamp on the bottom right. I barely even got that clamp on. I think I bonded some material to that so that I could secure that, basically allowing me to work on number 30. I went ahead and removed decay, a lot of decay on the buckle, going fairly deep there. I went ahead and welded on a spot well with a piece of copper band. Notice how it's not necessarily going around the whole tooth, but it's securing it nicely. And under the microscope, I can see what's going on, see what kind of gingival fluids are seeping through. In this case, there was nothing. I was able to add on a buildup there, get it nice and polished, and then the patient came out with a nice restoration. Bottom right is, so top left is the final product. Bottom right is, they came in last week, eight months out. There's a crown on there now. Don't really see any bone loss. However, they came back because tooth number 28 needed some treatment. However, I don't know if I can't really see this on the screen, but that tooth was fractured. So, but I was happy to see that this crown was sitting nicely on number 30. Let's see here. This is a upper left first molar, I think. Decay on the distal, going fairly deep there. This time I did use a copper band, but to seal the gap there, I packed some Teflon tape in there. Teflon tape is very, very useful. You can pack it, wedge it, sort of pack it in place and get it nice and smooth to seal the gaps there. Top left, I went ahead and fluted the margin so that I could just mimic the natural contour of the tooth, and then bottom right is the final. Honestly, in these cases, I think, yes, it's guarded, but with knowing that the seal is meticulously isolated and there's no leakage, I'm very confident in the bonding, where I'm fine. If this were my tooth, I'd be fine putting a margin onto that resin composite as well. So that's a case of deep margin elevation that I was talking about earlier. Then we have the cavit opal band matrix. Like I mentioned, I go down that sort of treatment checklist, Toffelmeyer, sectional band, et cetera, but if all else fails, I have at least have cavit opal dam to rely on. It is a fairly biocompatible material. I wouldn't want to leave it in place, but this works very well in those deep hemorrhaging locations, even onto bone area. I'll pack it in the interproximal after I've already done some barectomy of the gingiva, done some system B, got the hemostasis to work first, and then I'll pack some cavit in there. Because what cavit does is actually kind of just soaks up everything. It just gets everything nice and dry. And then what I'll do is I'll put some opal dam on top of that to secure, give it some rigidity. Here's an example of that. We have the first molar here. Here's substantial decay on the palatal. Patient wanted to save it despite the guarded prognosis. Looks like the decay goes almost to the bone level. Subgingivally, of course. So went ahead and cleaned everything out. So what I did was got it nice and cleaned out. I did some initial cleaning of the canals so that I could put a piece of gutta percha or paper point in there just to hold the space. What I did from there was I packed that whole area with cavit. Packed it with cavit, secured it with opal dam on the outside, and then what I did from there was basically just cleaned out the intaglio surface. Did a round burr, got it nice and clean on the inside so that there's no leftover residue or any residual surface contamination or anything from the cavit. Etched it, got it nice and clean. From there, did my bonding protocol, did a dual chem composite here, essentially rebuilt the wall freehand, the palatal wall, rebuilt that so that I can continue on with the root canal procedure. This one was fairly involved, so I did split it up into a couple of visits. There is the rebuild. I have calcium hydroxide in there and the cavit in the temporary. Brought the patient back 2 weeks later. Tissue, amazing. Patient's comfortable. Tissue just heals very well in these sort of situations so long as you know, the margins are clean. And so anyways, moved forward, completed the root canal, and happy with how that one turned out. Here is another case, deep on the distal here. Same thing, pretty much. You have cavit on the interproximal. Cleaned it out, got a nice bonding surface, built it up. Did a rough prep on the distal there, got it nice and cleaned out. Yeah, ready for the crown. Other cases, this patient actually, interesting, you know, I'm showing the right bottom right now, but they actually had the bottom left extracted. The plan was to do implants on that side, so they did all this grafting. Unfortunately, the surgeon had a very difficult time getting the graft to cooperate. Basically, he had to do a vestibuloplasty. There's a lot of extensive work on the bottom left side, so they're still undergoing that right now. So she had this, you know, a lot of cervical decay on the bottom right. I think it was, a lot of it had to do with medication. So she really wanted to try to save these teeth. And so, you know, I was on board, of course. I talked to her about the potential risks and complications. We went ahead and moved forward here. Started with number 30. I'll show you that one, but we actually ended up doing both because she was so happy with how 30 turned out. This time, I don't think I used the cavit opal dam, but I threw everything else at it. I did cord, I did Teflon, I did epi pellet, got it nice and bondable, polished it up, got a nice contour there, finished up the endo, and they were very happy with that. I think I only have a couple more here. Here's a top right molar, very deep distal buccal decay. Went ahead and cleaned that up. I'm not sure exactly which method I did here, but I think it was probably the cavit opal dam matrix. Did rebuild of that buccal surface. Got cleaned out and rebuilt. Here's another one, top right. Cleaned out, crown prepped, ready to go. Yeah, so that's it. But I figure I'll throw in a puppy at the end because everyone loves puppies. And this is Katsu. She's about 13, 14 weeks old now. I've had her for just over a month. Top left, or on the left side, we took her paddle boarding. On the right side, she just finished her puppy class yesterday. So go figure, it was over Zoom. So that's the way things are these days. So.
Good job.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Tran. Great presentation. Great cases.
Yeah. So, well, thank you all for joining. If there's any questions that you have, please feel free to ask. We're just about at the hour mark. Not sure if there's anything, but we'll stick around for a couple minutes.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Oh, great. I just, you know, have spent the past hour watching these very interesting and unusual cases. These are the challenges that I know Dan and Ali Rad look forward to coming into the office. I know that was actually just a joke. I know that they would prefer to have your run-of-the-mill standard endo cases coming in, but as endodontist, you know, it becomes second nature for us to do the routine cases. And sometimes we get these very interesting cases and challenging cases to come in, and it just makes our lives interesting. And as you can see with all the armamentarium and equipment that we have available at our practices, it just makes it a little bit more streamlined and routine. I want to thank everybody who took an hour or so off of their Thursday evening to join Ali Rad and Dan and saw some interesting endo cases. So I hope you take away something from tonight's lecture. And Gabby will send everybody who has registered via email a certificate. If you have not registered or you don't receive something from Gabby within the next week or so, make sure you email us and we will send a certificate out to you. Again, thank you very much, Ali Rad and Dan.
Oh, no problem. Thank you.
Someone was asking about the clamp name, so we'll put that back up on the screen here. Soaker Glickman, two words with a hyphen in between. I think someone else raised their hand as well. So.
Diana, do you have a question?
No, I pressed that mistakenly. Sorry. Thank you.
No problem. No problem.
Did someone else? I think. Q&A.
Q&A.
Oh. There's a question about what is a system B?
System B is the heated plugger that we use to do warm vertical condensation on the gutta percha. So to heat that up and compress it, you can change the temperature on it. So basically I'll use that and kind of crank it up a little bit. I'll put it to 400 degrees and use that for any sort of soft tissue, making sure I have the high volume suction, of course. Otherwise, start smelling barbecue.
Yeah.
Joanne raised her hand. Well, I go to the top. Yeah. Hi, Joanne.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Yes.
So a couple things. When you were talking about using Cavett and the Opal Dam, I'm not quite sure how you mean you're using the Cavett.
Yeah. So what I'll do, I mean, basically I think of it as a hemostatic tamponade, if that's the right word. So basically I'll just put it down and kind of pack it, condense it tight. Once I put it into the place at that interproximal area, I'll get a moist cotton pellet, not too moist, but I'll dab it and compress it apically in place. And then what happens is it kind of just sets up and hardens. Got to give it a couple minutes, of course. And once it does, I can go back in there and just take a burr to it and sort of carve out the inside.
Hmm.
To the margin itself, so that not only does the margin get cleaned up, but I remove the Cavett in the process, thereby making a nice clean surface for it. And what happens is, yes, the Cavett will stay in the interproximal once I've done the buildup itself, but I'll have to go back in and kind of remove it, whether it's with the Explorer or with the burr to clean up the interproximal. So it does need to be removed, but it's a great tool to manage any sort of.
Is this a syringeable Cavett? What kind of Cavett is that?
It's just in the jar. So it's the same Cavett.
Regular
Cavett. Yeah.
Oh, okay. That's very interesting. Thank you very much.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you all for joining.
Yeah.
That was actually very.
Hope you guys, yeah, hope you guys liked it. Thanks for joining, and looking forward to seeing you guys soon for other lectures. Right. Well, take care, everybody.
Yep. Have a good night.
Have a good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.